Le ministre des Enseignements secondaires a développé une plateforme d'enseignement à distance pour les élèves du secondaire au Cameroun. Une série d'enseignements dispensés par les enseignants de qualité pour les élèves du secondaire. Apprendre n'a jamais été aussi simple avec l'enseignement à distance. Une initiative du ministère des Enseignements secondaires sous la supervision du professeur Nalova Lyonga en collaboration avec le ministère des Postes et Télécommunications, la CAMTEL, la CIRTV et l'UNESCO. Nous introduisons l'enseignement à distance comme une autre méthode d'enseignement et d'apprentissage qui diffère du cadre de classe traditionnel auquel vous êtes habitué. Dans le mode d'enseignement à distance, vous n'êtes pas avec l'enseignant en personne, alors prenez votre temps, détendez-vous, écoutez l'enseignant, prenez des notes et visitez les liens suivants pour toutes questions ou réponses à vos préoccupations. Allez-y à votre rythme! La solution du Cameroun contre le Covid-19 et au-delà. Professeur Nalova Lyonga, ministre des Enseignements secondaires.
Welcome to this e-learning session. I am called Chair Vincent Fu. I am your physical education and sports teacher. I am going to be teaching the upper sixth class and we shall be having revision on what we have done so far since the first term right up to the end of the second term. Our plan for these holiday classes is articulated as shown on the table. We have the domain, the phase, and of course, number of presentation. So we are going to have two main presentations that are divided into two phases, phase one and two. And the first phase is athletics. That is divided into races, high jump, short put. And the second phase is the floor gymnastics. That is going to be handled in one presentation. The structure of the theory paper is as shown on the screen. We have the objective, which is to evaluate the capacities of learners to mobilize resources from physical education and sports to resolve problems in life. The duration of this paper is 2 hours, and of course, the coefficient is 2. So, the structure of the exams is as follows. The examination paper is on 20 marks. And the questions can be structured as follows. A question paper with 3 or 4 exercises drawn from 3 or 4 domains. A question paper equally can be of open exercises that can be drawn from 3 or 4 domains. And the last part or the last paper can equally be structured on the rules of the game and the general issues that concern the discipline. Phase one, which is athletics. Athletics actually is a group of discipline that concerns races, high jump, or you can say jumps in general, and of course throws. But following our program, we shall focus on races, high jump, and the short put. Now, talking about the races, we shall focus on the technical officials in races and how to organize a competition on races. Now, who is a technical official? A technical official is a person who controls a competition by applying the rules and regulations to make the disciplines the rules are respected by making sure those that are not respecting the rules are disqualified. And these people are responsible for applying the rules of the discipline to the latter. The attire of technical officials in races do vary. It depends on the organizers of the competition. As you can see on the screen, from the left to the right end, that the officials are putting on different attires. Materials used by technical officials. These officials have materials or equipment that they use in executing their respective functions. On your screen, you can see that there are three different types of cards with different colors. The first card, which is yellow and black. The yellow and black card is used to warn an athlete when he commits a fault. The green card, as you can see on your screen, is used to indicate that there is a technical fault committed by the organizers. Then, the last card, which has red and black color, is used to sanction an athlete or to disqualify him because of a fault. The next group of materials, as you can see on your screen, we have the gun or a pistol. This pistol is used to give the takeoff signal, and it is equally used to recall athletes in case of a false takeoff. We also have the clappers. The clappers have the same functions like the pistol or the gun, whereby they are used to give the takeoff signal or to recall athletes in case of a false start. Then we have the whistle. The whistle is used mainly for communication between the various officials, since they are positioned in very far off distances. So they are used to call the attention of the various officials. Now we have the yellow flag. The yellow flag is used by the race commissioners to indicate that an athlete has committed a fault in due course of running. We have a stopwatch. The stopwatch is used to take the time that an athlete used to cover a given distance. Then here we have the ladder. The ladder is used by the arrival judges at the level of the arrival line. They mount on it in order to have a better view of the athletes as they cross the finished line. Now, we are going to look at the positions and roles of the various technical officials. And we are going to consider the case of 100 meters. And looking on this image on our screen, you will notice that we have officials that are positioned at various areas. This is to make sure that they see all the athletes and make sure no athlete commits a fault and goes scot-free. In this regard, at this level here, we have the race commission, the race commissioners. The race commissioners here are there to make sure each athlete runs within his lane. Anybody who commits an infringement will be disqualified. And here we have the timekeepers. They are at the level of the arrival line to take the time of the athletes as they cross the final line. Then here we have the arrival judges. They are here to take the order of arrival of the various athletes. Then, at this end here, we also have some race commissioners who are equally here to observe if any athlete did not commit any fault along the lines. Looking at the functions of the judges, we are going to start with the chief judge. The chief judge ensures that the rules of the game are respected to the latter. On our screen, we can see here, this is the chief judge, and he is also responsible for disqualifying athletes in case of a fault. We can see the red and black card on his hand, indicating that the athlete has been disqualified. Looking at the position of the athlete equally, he is lamenting because he committed a silly fault for sure. And he is the main person who can take decisions on faults committed by athletes during a race. The starter is the person that gives the take-off command and signal. He gives the take-off command and signal. As you can see, he has a gun or a pistol on the hand. And from his action, we can imagine that he is saying, "On your marks, ready," and at the point where he says ready, he raises up the hand in order to fire the gun. So when he fires the gun, he gives the takeoff signal for the athletes to start running. The starter can also use the gun to recall the athletes in case of a poor takeoff, and he is equally responsible for disqualifying an athlete that does a false takeoff. The recall starter here equally has a gun, and when we look at his position, he is always positioned behind the takeoff line, behind the athletes. He has the role of assisting the starter. And of course, he also makes sure he positions the athletes on their right lanes and equally controls the regularity of the race at the starting point. He makes sure that no athlete commits a fault at the start. And if any athlete dares to commit a fault, that athlete is going to be disqualified. The starter's assistant, as you can see on the screen, he is in white and a blue jeans trousers. He is responsible for positioning and verifying if all the athletes are in their right lanes and positions before takeoff. He also verifies if the bib numbers and the hip or adhesive numbers are properly put in place, because they are useful, especially when we use the photo finish system. Now, we can see here a group of officials standing on the ladder that we saw before. We said earlier on that the ladder is used by the arrival or finish judges to stand on in order to have a clear view of the athletes as they cross the finish line. In this case, the ladder is placed at a distance of 5 meters away. At a distance of 5 meters away from the finish line, inward, as from the curb. And these judges play the role of establishing the order or ranking of the different competitors. The timekeeper. The timekeepers equally stand at the level of the arrival line, but on the outward lane. This is to avoid congestion between those in charge of taking the ranks of the athletes. They are responsible for taking the time of each athlete as they cross over the arrival line. Race commissioners. Race commissioners, we can see here on our image that they are standing at the extremes of the 100 meters track. We earlier on said they play the role of observing that the athletes do not commit a fault, like maybe crisscrossing, pushing, or slapping others. We have seen cases where an athlete deliberately slaps the other because he noticed that the other is going to win the medal. When you do that as an athlete, you are going to be disqualified. So these race commissioners play a major role in the observation of the athletes to make sure that they should not commit any infringement as they are running. Now, we are going to proceed to look at the positions of officials in the case of 200 meters after going through the case of 100 meters. We should note that a complete athletic track is 400 meters, and a race of 200 meters means the athletes are supposed to cover half of the distance of a complete athletic track. So, as you can see here, these are small white lines. We refer to them as staggers. This is the takeoff position for athletes that are competing in a 200 meters race. And here we still have the race commissioners positioned at different points along the track. They are there in order to make sure that all the athletes run while respecting their lanes. Failure to do so will cause them to raise the yellow flag, which entails a fault, and the chief judge will simply take action. And at the long run, the athlete may be disqualified. We equally have the arrival line judges, and here we also have the time keepers who are there to take time, while the arrival judges are there to take the order of arrival of the various athletes as they cross over the finish line. Now, talking about the position of athletes or the position of technical officials in 800 meters. We are through with the case of 100, 200, and now we are looking at 800 meters. We discovered that in 800 meters, the athletes are supposed to do two complete rounds because each round is 400 meters. So for them to cover the 800 meters, they need to go around the field two times. And that is the reason why we can see the various officials in these green triangles dotted all along the athletic track. This is to make sure that each athlete runs while respecting the rules of the game. Now, after talking about the roles of the various technical officials, in races. We shall now proceed to look at how we can organize a competition in races. And in order to organize a competition in races, we have to follow some steps. As you can see on your screen, we have the activities before the competition, during the competition, and after the competition. Activities before the competition. We have technical operations. And under this aspect, we need to carry out a homologation of the competition side. This should be done within a period of 3 months before the competition, so that we can have time to do the necessary adjustments. Here, we are supposed to make sure that the side of the competition meets up with the standards of the World Athletics, without which the competition will not take place. And we need to also do an inventory of the material needed. This should also be done within a period of 3 months before the competition. Here we need to look at the quality of the material and the quantity in order to make sure that we should not run out of stock when we are already in the competition. Now, we need to also do a verification of the equipments. We can have equipments, but if they are not of good standard, then it is useless. And this should be done at least 2 months before the competition. And we should note the type of materials that we need, the quality, and we should verify the conformity of the materials with the standards required by World Athletics. The finalizing technical documents must also be produced on time, because we need to make sure that all the participants are aware of the nature of the competition, the category of the ages of the people that are supposed to take part in the competition, the gender of the participants, the special rules that have been put in place just for that particular competition, and of course, the calendar of the competition. That is, they should know when exactly the competition is supposed to start and when it is supposed to end. Then, we need to also select officials that are going to partake and officiate over the competition. And in order to do this, we must match the number of officials with respect to the competition and the number of participating teams. And after making the choice of these officials, we now proceed to attribute their various roles in the competition so that there will be no mix-up. Preparation of the competition site. The competition site, after we must have discovered that it meets up to the standard of World Athletics, we shall then proceed to prepare the site. And there are certain things that can be done either a few days before the competition or on the same day based on the nature of the material that we are supposed to use. In this light, we shall start by mounting up big equipments a day before the competition, because when the equipments are too bulky, it becomes difficult to manage on the same day. So the bulky equipments will be mounted at least a day before the competition for security purposes, because if they are equally mounted earlier, they may equally steal or some may be destroyed. Then, for the case of small materials that are light and that can easily be handled and mounted without any difficulty, such materials can be mounted on the same day that the competition is about to begin. Then we equally need to put small materials at the competition site, some materials that we need to use that can be done on the same day without any problem. We are now going to look at the technical operations that are specific to races, insofar as the steps of organizing a competition can be very similar, but each has some specificities. It is in this slide that we are going to look at some technical operations that are specific to the organization of races. And for that to be done, we need to start with draws or balloting for the lanes. And we need to do balloting for races that vary from 100 meters to 800 meters inclusive. We need to do balloting for relays, be it 4 times 100 meters or 4 times 400 meters. The lanes shall be selected through a simple ballot. For the first round, the order of lanes shall be selected through balloting. 3 draws for lanes will then be done thereafter. 1 for the 4 highest ranked athletes or teams to determine placing in the 3rd, 4th, 5th and the 6th lane. Another for the 5th and the 6th ranked athletes or teams to determine the placing for the 7th and the 8th lane. And of course, the 3rd will be for the 2 lowest ranked athletes or teams to determine the placing in lanes 1 and 2. Now, for the 800 meters race, athletes can run 1 or 2 in the same lane in a situation where more athletes are occupying or more athletes are competing than the available lanes. Let's take a case whereby we have 10 athletes who are supposed to compete, and we have just 8 lanes. So the rules makes provision for the fact that if you have a situation like that, 2 athletes can run on 1 lane and there will be no problem. The minimum time between rounds. Here we are talking about if we have a competition whereby they start with the first round to look for those that can qualify for the next round on the same day. The athletes cannot just finish and go and start all over. So what is done is that after those taking part in 200 meters race have completed, they now have to rest for a period of 45 minutes. After they must have rested, they now can go and keep competing. For the cases of races that go right up to 1,000 meters, the athletes are supposed to rest for a period of 1 hour, 30 minutes or 90 minutes. This will permit them to recuperate the exhausted energy, because if they need to just go and start running at the same time, their performance will not be the best. Then, for races above 1,000 meters, they have a period of rest of at least a day. So when they must have run 1,000 meters, they need to rest for at least a day before they can keep competing. Other operations that need to be carried out as far as organizing the competition is concerned. We need to go to the call room and prepare a cupboard for keeping of the athletes' attires. We also need to make provision for easy communication between the secretary, timekeepers, and the chief judge. And of course, we need to also make the roll call in the call room in order to know the athletes that are present at the start of the competition. During the competition, this is the third phase, we are through with, rather this is the second phase, we are through with activities before the competition. Now we are a lot of activities during the competitions. The technical operations include, we need to accompany athletes to the platform. We need to respect the protocol of the field. And we need to give the race form to the chief judge, who is responsible for actually compiling the results in order to determine who is the winner. Next, validity of performances. What of validity of performances, we are simply trying to express the fact that for a particular performance to be validated, the competition must have been carried out while respecting the World Athletics rules, without which such a performance can never be normalized. Then the athlete's peep can always be used when we are using the photo finish system. And in this case, athletes may wear additional number identification of an adhesive tie that can be attached at the level of the short or lower part of the body. This is to enable the photo finish to easily see the number of the athletes. Now, during races, there are some faults that can lead to the disqualification of an athlete. And the first case that we're going to look at here today is the case of obstruction. Obstruction. Obstruction can be as a result of an athlete pushing another one. It can also be as a result of an athlete blocking the passage for the other, because when some of them are tired, they prefer to block their partners so that they should not bypass them. And the third case is when somebody prevents, or an athlete prevents somebody from progressing. That can be maybe through tackling or any sort of anti-sportsmanship that can result in the prevention of an athlete to continue running. The next fault that can also result in the disqualification of an athlete is lane infringement. Lane infringement occurs when an athlete, in fact, we should note that all athletes are supposed to stay within their allocated lanes from start to finish. Athletes must stay within their allocated lanes from start to finish. If you dare to leave your lane and move to another lane and obstruct or disturb another athlete, you are going to be disqualified. In 800 meters event, athletes shall run in their lanes up to the break line, which is 100 meters away from the kickoff point, after which they may now move to lane one. This is the only exception. But for the cases of 100 meters, 200 meters, and 400 meters, they are obliged to stay in their lanes. And even in the case of the 800 meters, they are supposed to run over a distance of 100 meters before now they can converge to lane one, depending on the fact that they actually need to do it or not. But it is advisable to converge, because when you keep running in a lane further from lane one, you know you are covering a longer distance than any other athlete. So any athlete that violates the rules of the game shall be disqualified. Leaving the track. An athlete, after voluntarily leaving the track, shall not be allowed to continue in the race and shall be recorded as not finishing the event. So if you are running And at one point, you just leave the tract and maybe go into the field. You are completely disqualified. You will not be allowed to continue. And if that happens, the track commissioner will simply raise up the yellow flag to indicate that there is a fault. And when he corners the chief judge, he will now explain the fault and you will simply be disqualified. Drinking and sponging. You know, in track events of 500 or 5,000 meters or more, organizers generally provide water and sponges to athletes so that they can easily rehydrate themselves. While in the case of events longer than 10,000 meters, refreshment, water, and sponging stations shall be provided because as they are running, they lose a lot of water and they need to take more water in order to hydrate themselves. If not, they may not be performant in the race. Rounds and hits. Rounds and hits actually come into play when the number of athletes are too large. We have many athletes. When this happens, an eliminatory round will be organized where those that will excel will have to qualify for the next round. And this eliminatory round is compulsory. The eliminatory round is compulsory to all the athletes. Anybody who refuses to take part in the eliminatory round is completely considered as not willing to take part and will be disqualified, provided he has no other issue to present. So the qualification rounds determines the best athletes. That is, it helps the best athletes to qualify for the next phase of the competition. Protest and appeals. In a case where an athlete feels that something went wrong pertaining to results or the conduct of the event, they have a period of 30 minutes. They have a period of 30 minutes after the announcement of the results by the officials to make their protest or to write an appeal. Failure to do that, the appeal will be null and void. Direct finals. This takes place for races of more than 800 meters, for relays which are longer than 4 times 400 meters, and for all the races that involve one complete round. The lanes and positions shall be drawn through balloting. So before it is done, they will go for a ballot for each athlete to know his lane where he has to compete. Tie for ranking position. The chief photo finish judge shall consider the actual times recorded by the athletes by extending to 3 decimal points. So when he extends to 3 decimal points, let's assume that if somebody ran for 9 seconds and we need, and there are two of them in that case, we will try to look at the next decimal point to 3 places in order to differentiate between who is faster or not. But if we go right up to the 3rd decimal point and they are still equal, then we shall proceed. We shall proceed to determine the tie through ballots. And by so doing, we shall be able to determine the best amongst the others. Now, after we must have finished our competition, we still have some technical operations to carry out. So at the end of the event, the athletes are actually guarded out of the playground out of the field respecting the protocol. We need to update the performance record to World Athletics. We also need to photocopy documents, a lot of the documentation in order to give to the various delegations. And of course, we need to hold evaluation meetings in order to know exactly how far the competition went on, you know, so that subsequently, when such competitions are going to be organized, we will obviously ameliorate, because evaluation helps us to look for the way forward as far as some loopholes were concerned. Then, we need to also award medals to the best. So here, you discover that this is the gold medal, position number one. This is the silver, position number two. And this is the bronze for the third place. And in some cases, if we realize that the performance is too good to the extent that we suspect that the person might have taken some drugs in order to improve on the performance, we will have to carry out an anti-doping control like what you are seeing here. We'll have to extract blood and then we carry out a test to find out if the person did not take some drugs in order to enhance his performance or not. Then, we have to then communicate the results and other issues to the organizing committee, the federations, and the media so that the media can relate to the world. And after that, we need now to reassemble all the equipments that were used that can be done a day or two after the competition so that we can preserve them for future use. We are now going to move to the second aspect of our revision today, which is high jump. And under high jump, we shall still observe the various technical officials in high jump, and of course, we are going to look at how we can organize a competition in high jump. So, looking at the technical officials in high jump, when you look at the image on your screen, you discover that we have different letters. These letters are indicating the various positions or displacements of the technical officials in high jump. Now, the letter C, as you can see on the image, indicates the position of the chief judge. Here, you can see this image indicating, showing the picture of the chief judge. We can discover that he has two flags on his hands. The red flag that he just raised up and the white flag that is down. We shall get to know the functions of the various flags as far as the high jump is concerned. So, the chief judge has as function the distribution of tasks to the various officials, and of course, there are various positions. He actually oversees the competition, making sure everything goes on smoothly. He equally has the role to verify the materials that are to be used during the competition. And he equally validates or annuls or cancels a trial, depending on whether there was a fault or not. Now, we have these two letters, B1 and B2. And of course, this part here is the landing mat. This is the landing mat of the high jump. And what here we consider this to be the cross bar or the transverse bar. So the judges B1 and B2 play a role in putting the crossbar back in position when it is pushed by an athlete during flight when he is jumping. If he mistakenly touches the bar and he falls off, these two judges are in charge of replacing it in place. They are also in charge of raising the bar under the instruction of the chief judge to the next height. The secretary, as you can see here, this is the position of the secretary. He handles the result sheet and calls up each athlete. So he is in charge of recording the results of all the athletes and for calling them up to participate in the race or in the high jump. Here we have the letter P. The letter P, as you can see here, is the indicating the position of the scoreboard judge. The scoreboard judge is in charge of displaying the start lists and the results of athletes. So he displays the start list at the beginning of the competition and then equally presents the result of the athletes as they are passing. We have the timekeeper. Here is the position of the timekeeper. So the timekeeper, as you can see, have just raised a yellow flag while looking at his watch. He controls the execution time and signals with a yellow flag when 15 minutes are left. So if you are caught up and you waste time to execute your jump, by the time we have just 15 minutes left, the timekeeper will raise up the yellow flag to indicate to the athlete that the athlete has just 15 minutes left. Judge A is in charge of checking athletes, collecting the result sheets, also doing roll call, and of course, he also follows up athletes to indicate at what height they will start participating. Because there are some athletes that would prefer not to start at a very low height and to waste energy, but rather to start at a particular height where they think they can easily jump and win a medal. Organization of the competition. Activities before the competition. We are going to look at some technical activities or operations that are specific to high jump. So, here we need to, of course, do some warm-up. And for the warm-up here, each athlete is supposed to have 2 high jump tryers during warm-up. And they need to respect the stipulated time for the warm-up. Then, this warm-up is also being done under the strict supervision of the judges. The final preparations before the competition proper. The participants need to be called up. They need to register their respective heights where they think they can start jumping, where we call initial heights. And we need to announce the initial height, the basic initial height that the organizers have decided that this is where we need to start. And we need to place the bar at the initial height for jumping to begin. During the competition now, we need to follow the order based on the balloting because we need to do the ballot and inform the secretary on the order of passing. And each athlete is supposed to respect the order. And as they are passing, the judges are supposed to be keen in observing. So here we can see that an athlete is already in the flight position over the bar. And to that end, in white and black, we can see a judge who is very keen and observing the athlete supervising or the athlete doing the job. From the position of the judge, we can easily deduce that it is a bar judge who is responsible to raise up the bar when it falls off. Now, when these athletes are jumping, the secretary needs to note down the results. And noting down the results has a format. We should note that each athlete has the right for 3 complete tries for each height. So if you miss the first time, you have the right to go for the second time. If you miss the second time, you are free to go for the third time. And if you miss the third time, that is when you are disqualified. On the other hand, athletes can also decide not to jump at a particular height that they deem too low for them to jump. So looking at the image on the screen, you discover that the starting height during this competition is 1.75 meters. That's the height. So when we look at the athletes A, B, C, and D, we discover that athlete A started jumping at 1.75. And this letter O shows that he jumped correctly without committing any fault. So the trial is referred to as a valid trial. Now, why athletes B, C, and D did not do any attempt at this level? When we go to 1.80 meters, we noticed that athlete A had a failed trial that is indicated by letter X during the first trial, and during the second trial, he had to jump successfully. Same for B. Why C had a successful jump as the first attempt, why D, just like A and B, also failed the first time and validated the second time. We now move to 1.84 meters. Here, A validated the very first time, B did not attempt, C failed the first trial, just like D, and both of them validated the second trial. Now, we'll move to 1.88 meters. We discover that both of them failed the first time and validated the second time. At 1.91 meters, we discover that A failed and stopped attempting, B did not attempt, C did not attempt, D had 3 failed trials. We now move to 1.94 meters. We discover that A had 2 failed attempts, B did not attempt, C had 3 failed attempts, and B had 3 failed attempts at 1.90 meters. So a failed trial. A trial is considered as a failed trial when the athlete takes off with 2 legs, or when the athlete pushes off the bar, or when the athlete passes under the bar, and finally, when the athlete touches the uprights. Qualification round. A qualification round is always used when the number of athletes are many. So the qualification round is used to eliminate some of them before we can now select the best that will compete at the level of the finals. And just like in the case of races, we discover that even in high jump, the qualification rounds are obligatory. Anybody who refuses to partake will be disqualified. Time of trials. As you can see on our screen, on the table, we discover that the time of trial is based on the number of participants. Here we have 30 seconds for more than 3, and we have 9 seconds for 2 or 3 for the case of individual races. One, we have 180 seconds, and for consecutive trials, we have 120 seconds. And then for the combined event, we have 30 seconds for the first case, 90 for the second, 120 for the third, and of course, 120 again for the last case, which involves consecutive trials. The yellow flag is always raised 15 seconds to the end of the recommended trial time. Results. The best trials in the whole event, including the ones executed during a tie to gain the first place are considered. What we are saying here is that if you are doing your jumps, if your best trial is 1.88 meters in a particular series of trials, you might have done your three trials. The first trial you were at 1.88 meters, the second you are 1.70 meters, and the third you are at 1.82 meters. We are going to consider but the highest performance. So your best trial will be 1.88 meters. So we always take but the best trial among the trials that you have executed. Classification. We have a procedure of attributing positions to the participants. Here, the athlete with the least number of trials at the last successful level will be the first. So what we are saying here is that if all athletes ended at, let's say, 1.50 meters, and let's say athlete A did just two trials and ended at 1.80 meters, athlete B did four and also ended at 1.50 meters. Well, if we want to classify the two, we are going to take athlete A to be the first because he did just two trials. The more trials you make and the more failures you have, the lesser your performance. But if there is a tie, the athlete with the least number of failures will be the first, just like I've just explained. If the tie persists for the first position, they shall proceed to a jump over trials. We are going to proceed to another trials. And in this case, each participant will be eligible just to a single trial. So that if you fail to jump and the other person jumps, then the other person will be the first. So if you look at this, our table here, we have the jump overs, and we have here, it is the table that we have first of all looked at. When we look keenly, we will discover that all of them actually failed at 1.88 meters because all the other trials are futile. So when we look at here and we try to look at the number of failed trials, we discover that before the area where they actually had their last best attempt, A has 1 and 2. So here we come and put it here under failed trials, two failed trials. So we are taking the failed trials based on the level where their best performance ended. So that's why here A has 1 and 2. Okay, and B also have 1 and 2, C 1 and 2, YD has 1, 2, 3. So if we were to look at their performances, we'll discover that here the person that has the least number of trials will emerge first. But now that we have two people with the same number of failed trials, implies we need to go for a jump over trial. And in that case, since they ended at 1.88, we are going to end at 1.92 here and permit them to jump. So when we place the bar at 1.92, we discover that A could jump, while, in fact, A and B could jump. We went now to 1.94, A could not jump, and B could jump. So if we were to do our classification now, we discover that since this person already had three failures only at the level of 1.8 meter, he is going to be last. Then, based on the number of failures here, since C had just two failed trials before the last trial where he was successful, we are going to put him at the third position. And here we discover that B jumped at a level of 1.94, so he is going to be first. And A, that failed at a level of 1.94, will be there second. So that is how we are going to proceed in order to differentiate between athletes that are performing very well and that need to be differentiated. Now, we are going to move to the third part of our lesson, which is short put. Short put, equally, we are going to look at the technical officials in managing short put competitions and how we can organize competitions in short put. Below, on your screen here, we can see an image that shows the positions of the various technical officials in short put. So, we are going to look at their various functions. So, the chief judge watches over or oversees the whole event, verifies the measurements, and of course, has two flags in his hands in order to validate or to invalidate a trial. We have two judges. The two judges are responsible for checking whether the put has been made correctly. So when a short put is thrown, they have to verify if the athlete did it correctly or not. And after that, they now measure the distance or the performance of that athlete. Judge Chu plays the role of holding the measuring tape from the inside edge of the stop board to the closest side of the shot where it landed. Judge 3 immediately places a mark using a spike where the mast landed, while Judge 4 positions the spike at the point where the mark land has been placed, ensuring the tape is on the zero mark. Judge 5, on his part, is responsible for retrieving the implements and returning them to the implement stand or placing them in the return chute. While Judge 6 records the results on the sheets and equally calls the name of the next athlete who has to pass. Judge 7 is in charge of the scoreboard. So he presents the performance and the number of the athletes on the scoreboard for public view. Judge 8, on his part, is in charge of indicating to the athlete that they have a certain time to take their trial. We now have Judge 9, who is in charge of controlling the athlete. Organization of competition. We also have three parts. We have before the competition, and here we are going to observe some technical operations that are specific to short put. Here we shall start with balloting in order to get the order of passing. We have to proceed to the warm-up trials where each athlete is entitled to do some warm-ups, and they are supposed to do two trials while respecting the time frame. And this is always done under the strict supervision of the judges. During the competition now, the technical operations. Here we shall look at trials or attempts that are executed. So the trials are executed from the circle. And of course, they maintain a stationary position in the circle. The stop board may be touched inside, but not at the top. The put is launched from the chin position by the neck by extending the arm. And of course, the arm always forms an angle of 90 degrees with the body. So you hold your put by placing your arm by your chin, and the put should also be touching the neck so that you can easily extend your hand while projecting the put upward and forward as far as possible. Validation of trials. The athlete should throw correctly. If you don't throw correctly, the trial will not be validated. And if you leave the circle of throw through the bag decision, the bag zone, the trial will be validated. But if you move out to the front zone, the trial will be cancelled because the rule states that after throwing, you must move out through the backward zone. Now, we are going to look at some examples of disallow or failed trials. The athlete throws in a faulty manner as shown in the following images. So we discover that this athlete here has removed the implement away from the chin and by the neck. When you do this, that trial is going to be cancelled. Then, this other image here, image 2, the athlete have stepped out of the throwing circle. If you do that equally, that trial will be cancelled. We also have cases whereby the athlete, after throwing, touches the stop board with the hand. If you do that, that trial is cancelled. And here he has climbed on top of the stop board. That makes the trial to also be cancelled. Here, this athlete on image 3 is moving out of the throwing circle towards the forward zone, and that makes the trial to be cancelled. And in image 4 here, we have trials that have been made. Here we have 1, 2, and 3. The second trial is on the line. When you throw directly on the line, that trial also is not validated. The passing time for a trial. Each athlete has a maximum of 1 minute. So for consecutive trials, they have 2 minutes. Replacement of trials. If for any reason beyond the control of the athlete, if his actions are hampered while he is trying to throw, that trial is going to be replaced because that disturbance may affect his performances. So the referee shall have the authority to award to an athlete a replacement trial or to reset the time, either partially or in full, when he feels that the athlete was disturbed in due course of trying to throw. Now, we are going to look at measuring the performances of athletes. So, when the athlete throws, the spike will be placed here and the tape pulled right up to the center of the circle in order to get the performance of the athlete. So two people are responsible. First of all, we have the identification of the landing area by pinning a spike there. And thereafter, we now bring our tape to the nearest 0 point and we stretch right up to the center where we can now get the performance of the athlete. Qualification round. When the number of athletes are too large, when we have so many participants, all athletes shall compete in the qualification round and only the best shall be selected for the finals. And we should note that the qualification round is obligatory to all athletes. So, 3 qualification trials shall be allowed per athlete. Results. Each athlete shall be credited with his best performance amongst his trials. Classification of the various athletes. So here we see on that table, we just saw that is how the athletes are classified. So we shall now proceed to look at some exercises. The first exercise is on races. And here, you are supposed to answer true or false by marking an X in the right column. So the first question is, the assistant starter verifies the beeps of athletes? Of course, our answer here is true, because that is the role of the assistant starter. Next question. The timekeeper stops his watch when any part of the body crosses the final line. The timekeeper stops his watch when any part of the body crosses the final line. The answer here is false. Let's take, for example, that if somebody crosses the leg first, you cannot stop the watch at that time because the leg is not considered. We consider it as from the chest upward. Next question. The timekeeper stops his watch when any part of the chest crosses the final line. Correct. So when the chest, from the chest upward, if any part crosses, then we will assume that you have crossed and your time will be taken. Next assertion. In 100 meters, an athlete puts his foot in another lane without disturbing is disqualified. True or false? False. When you just put your leg mistakenly without disturbing another athlete, you are not disqualified, because we assume that you can also have a kind of small disequilibrium and in due course of struggling to balance your body, and you can step your leg elsewhere. In 800 meters on lane where there are 10 athletes, the chief judge requests the assistant starter to put 2 in lane 8 and 2 in lane 6 for the race to take place. Is it authorized to do so? True or false? True, of course. We saw it in our revision that when we have more athletes, especially 800 meters, it is possible for 2 athletes to run in the same lane, given the fact that they have to change their lanes at the break line area. Next question. In 800 meters, the beep with the number is on the chest. True or false? Yes? Good. True. In 800 meters, the beep has to be on the chest for clear viewing. Next question. In 100 meters, the last athlete changes his lane before crossing the final line. He has to be disqualified. True or false? False. When you are really last, it shows that you even have nothing to ride home with. So given the fact that he even crossed and he did not cause any crime by pushing an athlete, and that is even the last, where you have nothing to go home with, it is useless to be disqualifying him, because the performance already disqualifies such an athlete. Next question. In bends, running on the left line in a lane leads to disqualification. When you are at the bend and you leave the lane and you are running on the line, sure, you are trying to reduce your distance. So if you do that, then you are going to be disqualified. Next question. In 100 meters, what is the duration for measuring the effect of winds? 10 seconds, correct. Next question. What is the length of the zone of transmission in relays? 20 meters, correct. Question 3. In case of a foul during the transmission of the baton, the judge raises which of the flags? Is it the white, red, or the yellow flag? The yellow flag. Question 4. What is the function and duties of a race commissioner? Observe athletes crossing over the hurdle. Good. Question 5. In which race is the anemometer used? In 100 meters and 200 meters, correct? Next question, the time taken for different athletes, rather, what is the role of the arrival judges? Here we score, the role is to place the athletes in order. We now have some open questions. In the table, we say in the table below, come up with a plan for organizing a competition. So the table here clearly shows the plan, how competitions can be organized. We have before, during, and after. And these are the activities that have to be carried out, and of course, the duration. Exercises on high jump. Here you are supposed to answer true or false. First question. A high jump judge can stop the race from taking place at the same time taking place at the same time with races. True or false? False. The race can be going on and the high jump can be going on. So that's why we talk of field and track events. Next question. An athlete that passes under the bar can be authorized to repeat the trial. True or false? False. That trial is null and void. Next question. An athlete had a failed trial of at 30 meters and stopped the second trial. You are saying that an athlete decided not to take a trial at a particular distance and now decided to continue. Will you authorize the trial or not? That when you stop at a particular level, it becomes difficult for you to continue. Next are sessions. The yellow flag shows that the athlete have to wait for some time. True or false? False. It shows rather that the athlete need to hurry up because he has just 15 minutes left. Next question. Jump off should be used to separate athletes in case of tie in high jump. True. Next question. The secretary validates attempts in high jump. Secretary validates attempts in high jump. True or false? False. He records results. On a completion form for high jump, the sign O indicates a successful trial. True or false? True. In a high jump competition with 7 athletes, an athlete has 2 minutes to execute a trial. True or false? False. Open questions. An athlete places the foot on the white line at a point zero during impulsion, but did a good flight. Which flag will be raised by the judge? The red flag. Next question. In a table, indicate the signs used to represent a disallowed attempt, a non-attempted trial, and a valid trial. So, failed trial, we have X. Non-attempted, we have a dash, and a valid trial, we have zero. So the image below shows the position of technical officials in high jump. So we are expected to give the functions of the chief judge, judge one, judge two, and the third judge. So the chief judge attributes functions to judges, validates trials, and verifies measurements. Judge one and two, that are referred to as upright judges, they have the role of replacing the bar in position and of course to raise the bar to the new height as prescribed by the chief judge. And then the secretary, who is judge 3, handles the results form to rule call for athletes. Now we have the classification table. We are expected to complete the table by indicating the final performances. So when we look at the table, we will discover that the athletes have different performances at different levels. So we are going to give the performances and at the end we are going to classify them based on merit. So those are the various performances. So now we have the first position, that is 218. We also have the second, that is also 218, but the difference here is that the first has less trials than the second, or less failures than the second. Then the third has 215, the fourth 215 also. Here the difference is also a level of the failures. The fifth 212, the sixth, there are two of them, they have the same number of failures and valid trials. Then we have the ninth, that is a 212. So classification, that's the classification table for athletes that have performed the jump. So now we are going to move to the exercises on short put. I also have a series of questions that we are going to respond either true or false. So the first assertion, in a short put competition, an athlete has 1 minute 30 seconds to execute his trial. True or false? False. I ask just 1 minute. Next question. For the trial to be valid, the athlete must wait for the put to land before he goes out of the circle. True or false? True. If you go out before the put lands, then that trial will be cancelled. Next question. An athlete can throw all his trials at once. True or false? Of course, it's false. You have to go gradually and sequentially. Next assertion, an athlete can move out of the circle through the front zone. True or false? False. The only zone that is authorized to move out is through the back zone. Next, the land judge has the role to return the put. True or false? True. He has to pick the put and send it back. Next, the circles for short put, hammer and discus, have the same dimensions, true or false, or diameters, true or false? False, the diameters are different. Next question, during short put throw, an athlete touches the top of the put or the top of the stop board and the trial is valid, true or false? False. We saw in our lectures that if you touch the top of the stop board, that trial is cancelled. Next question. A judge lifts up a yellow flag to indicate a fault. True or false? False. It is lifted up to indicate that 15 minutes are left for the time allocated. Next question. A judge lifts up a white flag to indicate a valid trial. True. Next question. During warm-up, athletes can throw in any order. False. They must respect the balloting order. Now we are going to move to some multiple choice questions. And you are supposed to mark an X against the right answer. First question, in short put throw, the implement have to be thrown back into the circle. A judge have to bring back the implement. The athlete look for the implement. Answer. The answer is a judge have to bring back the implement. Question two. After being called up, how much time do they have to execute a trial? 1 minute, because the time allocated for each trial is 1 minute. Next question. After the first trial, or after the first three trials, the eight best shall qualify for the next round. In what order are they going to throw? The first order is the reverse order of their temporal classification in a new balloting order, in the order of roll call. The right answer is in the reverse order. So those whose performances are poor will start the throws. Next question. The chief judge in a national competition. First proposal, validates trial. Second proposal, verifies the classification order. Next proposal, call up the athletes. And the last proposal, registers performances. Right answer. He validates trials. That's the main role of the chief judge in competitions. Open questions. Open questions. When does the chief judge raise the red flag? When does the chief judge raise the red flag? The chief judge raises the red flag when the athlete uses an unauthorized approach to throw or when there is a fault. Let's take, for example, going out towards the front zone, throwing out of the landing sector, smashing the top of the stop board, touching any part out of the circle, moving out of the circle before the mass or the put lands, and of course, removing your hand backward when throwing. All of these will result to a faulty throw that the chief judge now will raise the red flag to indicate that that trial is null and void. Question 2, what is the use of the yellow flag? We all know the chief judge have two flags. The red flag that we have already seen the use up here, and of course, the yellow, the chief judge have two flags, red and the white. The yellow flag is being used by the timekeeper. And now we have been asked to give the role of the yellow flag. Let's now look at the role of the yellow flag. It is used to indicate that 15 minutes are left for a trial. We all know that each trial is supposed to be executed for a period of 60 seconds or 1 minute. So, if an athlete is not very conscious, when there are just 15 minutes left, the timekeeper will raise the yellow flag to indicate to the athlete that he's having just 15 minutes to execute the trial. Failure to do that, that trial or the attempt will be cancelled. So it is like a warning flag that indicates to the athlete that you have just 15 seconds. And if the athlete is conscious enough, he can execute the trial within that time frame. So, having looked at all what we did during the first and the second term, I believe you are almost ripe for your end of course examination, because what we have done so far covers the work from the first and the second term. So, we expect you to revise your notes regularly so that during the next class, when we shall be looking at our next revision under phase 2, which is titled phase 2, you will not have problems. So, see you next class, and what you need to revise is floor gymnastics. Una tege si matege yop, una tege minga matege nyum, una tege majang matege ndom, mane tambia ninya ne njubya yen, ngani bana matege mot, ngani la kiri watege ndong, esa kina bia dinkido, mane tambia ninya ne njubya yen, tam tama mote tam zabike, tam tama tonge tam zabike, tam tam tama mote tam zabike, mane tambia ninyane njubya yen.